Welcome to the Black Announce Table. From the 718, right off the beam, the man with the silkiest do-rag, Manny. From Virginia by way of Europe, he gives his all every week, Cody Brick. Live and direct from Strong Island, the certified good you, Sky High E. You're listening to the Black Announce Table.
I like your guys' style.
Hi, weirdos!
Look at us.
Late with the Q.
Hello!
Now it's official.
You see how I said we need a recap mania for tax write-offs and then KP put the camera back on?
Hey.
What's the word, fellas?
We here, man. Feeling good. WrestleMania weekend, man. I know you guys got some good stories to tell us and all of that good stuff, man.
Absolutely exhausted.
Yeah,
I know it.
This is obviously going to be a WrestleMania episode, post show recap, whatever you want to call it. I just want to shout out real quick to everybody that was at Mania from Thursday or Wednesday, however long, from the beginning to literally Monday or Sunday, bro. That shit, it is not for the weak. It is not for the meek. You know what I'm saying? You have to be strong to survive Mania weekend, bro. I did the drive, you feel me, from New York to Philly on Saturday morning. Did the NXT show. And then, you know, drove back for Mania. Bro, that right there had me spent. So I could only imagine Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Like, nah, bro. I'm good, man.
I have no idea how people were able to do the Thursday into the Monday of just events, not even including all the travel and everything like that. Because I was there from Friday, didn't go to SmackDown because we got in too late because we went to the opening day at the Yankee game. But we did all the events for Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. So I only got 3 days worth of events. That's basically half. Everybody else who was able to do everything else, more power to them. I would have needed a couple C4s like KP if I was going to be able to make it through and do all those events.
Yeah, it's a beast of a weekend. I didn't do all the events physically. I just couldn't. I have in the past, but it takes a lot. And this year, you know, WWE is touting, you know, they're breaking all these records, but they're breaking all these records because WrestleMania costs $200 to just get in the fucking building, you know. So not only is it a lot of events to take in, it's really expensive to do all these things. So shout out to the diehard fans that, you know, really save up the bread for this. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is our weekend. And yeah, man, we got some stories to tell.
Well, hey, y'all saved up for this? I put it on my credit card.
Well, that voice you hear, that's differently. That is super producer KP. Everybody on YouTube, that's KP, by the way.
Thanks.
You know what I'm saying? But that's why I'm here, because I know y'all got the stories and I know y'all was doing y'all thing and everything. So I'm here. I wanna know it all. I wanna know everything. That's why I'm here. So I'm gonna be in the cut. You know what I'm saying? I wanna hear it all.
Y'all want to start with NXT?
Even before NXT, Friday, an unnatural occurrence happens.
Oh yeah.
I'm chilling in my crib. I don't know about y'all. I don't know about how gutty y'all get, but one of my favorite breakfasts is mashed potatoes and scrambled eggs.
What?
I feel like growing up, that was a meal. They start you off in the day because they get It gives you everything you need. You know, all you need is a couple of potatoes and scramble some eggs. Boom, you're good. You're good for the day. So yeah. I'm.
I just want to say when Banks hears this, he's gonna fucking die laughing. Because Banks, I told you about Spanish people be giving their kids heavy ass breakfast, bro. Potatoes. Yo, I was not lying, nigga. I told you, and this nigga just proved me right, bro.
Wait, y'all never did mashed potatoes with scrambled eggs, bro.
Throw that heavy. Are you a lumberjack, nigga? With that heavy ass breakfast. You about to chop some wood, nigga? Bro,
it makes all the sense in the world now.
Sometimes you never know how long it's gonna be until your next meal, so you gotta, you know.
That's crazy.
Nigga, eat some toast like a real.
And it's not just like fried potatoes. He said mashed potatoes, which.
Yeah.
Is a lot. That's milk, butter. Like, come on, bro.
Heavy whipping cream and shit.
Yeah, like, no, bro.
Anyway, I'm eating my good breakfast, mashed potatoes, scrambled eggs. And my boy Levi came from North Carolina. So he spent the night in my crib.
Shouts to Levi.
Yeah, absolute legend. Levi, Eve met him when Levi was about six drinks in. This kid. I'm eating breakfast. Levi's in the bathroom getting ready, and my stepdad's also getting ready. And so I'm downstairs, I'm eating, and then I hear like a bunch of rattling, a bunch of shaking, and it's just like really loud in my crib. I'm looking around, I'm like, is somebody doing like laundry? Is my washing machine broken? So then I feel everything shaking. And I'm like, all right, now it's been like 30 seconds. I'm like, what the hell is going on? So then it gets even louder, bro. I ran upstairs, knock on the door, tell my stepdad. I'm like, yo, what are you doing? He's like, it's an earthquake. So now we're running down to the basement to make sure the foundation's, you know, all good. Nothing's crazy. And looking back,
that's the worst. That's
the worst thing you can do.
I went to the most dangerous part of the crib. Yo, where can everything land on me? Let me go there. But. So the earthquake happens, and I'm sitting there. I'm like, oh, my God. It's my first opening day ever. And, of course, a fucking earthquake happens. So now in my head, I'm like, oh, everything's going to get canceled. Mm-hmm. So I'm just sitting there on my island, eating the rest of my food just tight because I'm like, yo, this game's going to get canceled. Something got destroyed because if my house sounded that loud, something got messed up somewhere.
Yankee Stadium is fucking nothing but rubble and ash right now.
Exactly. And that it's already in on 167, so, or 161. So it already looks like that. So we go to the game anyway because we're like, fuck it. Get to the game. No problems. Everything's good. We're driving back. We pick because on the way back to my crib, we're going to pick up my boy. So our other friends that rented the Tesla for the weekend can pick us up at my crib, and we all leave together. Well, my car starts shaking. I'm like, yo, what the fuck happened to my car? I think my car's about to break down. No. That's like when the second earthquake or the aftershock happened. I'm sitting there. I'm like, bro, two in one day. I just want to make it to Philly, bro. Don't even want to hear nothing about this. Bro, we get to the – hold on. Who should I send this video to? Should I put it in the Black Announce Table Twitter?
You know it.
All right.
You know
because
it.
Because I didn't even think about it until right now. We pull up to the Airbnb. Oh, my God. Philadelphia, you're nothing but trenches and colonialism. There's no in between. There's no like, oh, wow, this is nice and modern. It's you're either in the trenches or you're in post-revolutionary America. But y'all gotta see this motherfucking my fault. Oh, the volume's not going down. Y'all gotta see this Airbnb. You know, we canceled our first Airbnb because it ended up being too big because we thought we were gonna have a bigger group, and we opted in for a smaller one. And it's called like Upper Darby, Philadelphia, or some shit like that. Upper Darby. We passed by at least 3 to 4, you know, strung out, you know, drug addicts. I don't know if they're addicted or, you know, it was their first time, but They were dialed in. So, Philadelphia, get it together. We need to send Eric Adams to Philly, actually. Oh, nice. I actually sent the video to a girl by mistake.
You sent it to a she?
Yeah.
I sent it to a she.
Man. Yo, so real quick, this earthquake, son. So I'm at work. I get to work. I'm parked up. And I didn't even know it was an earthquake till like my the two group chats was like, yo, was that an earthquake? Nigga, the whole time I'm in the whip, like I'm posted up, and I just feel like my whip rocking. So I'm like, yo, is somebody outside pushing my whip? Like, first I'm like, yo, is it heavy winds? So you know me, I'm like, yo, if it's heavy winds, let me see what's going on outside. Nigga, trees ain't moving. You feel me? And shaking and shit like that. Shit ain't flying. So I'm like, hold on, nah, something's up. I go outside, look at my whip. I'm like, yo, nobody's pushing. I'm thinking somebody's over here pushing my whip and shit. Nobody's pushing my whip. Go on the timeline. He was like, yo, that was an earthquake. I'm like, oh, that's crazy. This is the first time in my life I've experienced a natural disaster like this. You know what I'm saying? Actually, Sandy was pretty wild. I ain't gonna lie. Sandy fucked the city up.
Sandy went type crazy.
Yeah, nah, Sandy was type wild. But first time I ever experienced an earthquake, I'm like, yo, this shit wild, boy. My car was over here doing the Jimmy.
Your car was a main event Honda.
Hell yeah. Main event CRV. We made it out though. I'm just glad because yo, we was working on a deck that day. Niggas had to rip out mad like lumber and shit like that. Thank God the deck did not fall on me. You know what I'm saying?
Damn.
You know,
you should have pitched that to the guy you were building the deck for. Like, yo, look, this shit can withstand an earthquake.
Yeah, that's his old shit. That nigga be like, word. So I don't even need to rebuild it then.
He like, fired you.
Niggas said, put all this shit back. You out of here. But yeah. So you get there Friday.
Realize our Airbnb is actually in the trenches. I sent a video to the... I should have sent by now. So that's a little tour of the upstairs of what the Airbnb looked like.
Let's see what this B&B looking like.
It told us it had enough beds for 6 people. Turns out it only had 2 actual bedrooms, 2 whatever you're about to seize, and 2 futons in the living room.
Bro, take this in there. Look at these
futons.
Bro. Look how unangled this shit is, bro.
I'm not gonna hold it. I don't
look
at, bro, it's too hot up here. What is that?
I don't know.
Open
it.
Listen,
Levi,
if it's too hot, I got it.
Well, let me look downstairs.
This is perfectly fine. Well,
look at the staircase, bro.
Terrifying.
They put handlebars on the wall.
Shower handlebars.
Nah, it smells like shit, too. Did somebody.
Do you see how the staircase is like that?
Yo, these kids is fucking dangerous, bro.
Yo, give them a tour of the room. Give them a tour of the room.
This is JC's tour of the room. We're gonna get Josh 30 right now. Look.
Walk-in closet. Walk-in closet. I don't really got much headroom, but you know, we're making it with amenities.
Yo, tie your fucking shoes, bro. My shit's on you, bro.
Yo, look. Yo.
Man, this is not safe. All it takes is one brick and a whoa.
Yo, one step is all it takes.
This is bullshit, bro. What do you gotta do to get downstairs?
Yo, this is yo. My pick stains are going crazy right now. I'm not working.
Bro, the ceilings are 4 feet high.
I gotta do the limbo.
Nah, bro.
Many fit right under
me. Nah, we can't get drunk, bro.
Oh my god.
Son, this young man was staying at a hostel
environment. This shit was not just hostel or a hostel, my fault. But yeah, so we get to the Airbnb. We, a couple of us, you know, were pre-gaming in the V, you know, on the way over. So we get there and we're crying because we're like, of course we cancel a fucking basically a mansion and end up having to stay in some bullshit like that. So we wake up the next day, go to NXT. We all got belts. We pull up with, you know, with the titles in hand. We pull up everybody. We coordinated to everybody had to bring a flag. We even talked to KP and Eve about everybody, you know, bringing flags to NXT. But we get through the door. They're like, yo, no flags allowed. I was like, no, my friend's not gay. He just looks that way. They were like, nah, the flag's in your pocket. Can't do it. Oh, no drop. All right, cool. I listen. The joke passed.
you just kept going, so my bad.
So we go, you feel me? I felt like I was in a UFC press conference right here. But we walk in there, we sit down, bro. Everybody, because you have to walk through there to get to like the floor seats and stuff like that, bro. Everybody who got floor seats, they would stop by, dap us all up. People, random people taking pictures of us, stuff like that. So now everybody's, you know, cool with us. A couple producers walked over. They were like, yo, nah, y'all killed this shit. So I'm like, yeah, you know, we're feeling it.
Yeah, that is a hard picture, by the way. But
thank you. So one of the producers comes over and he's like, yo, y'all might, you know, get some action in this area now. So, you know, be on the lookout. I'm like, oh, what's going on now, bro? So, you know, later on in the show, Carmelo and our boy Frigg Williams, you know, they get into a little, you know, scuffle outside of the ring, go over the barricade. And this is me about, like, I think this is what, maybe 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. I've already hammered 7 drinks, so I'm watching this. I'm watching this acting like it's a real bar fight, bro. I was so lit at this time.
We could tell.
Nigga, it's cheesing.
I was having the time of his life. Exactly. Bro, I was absolutely dialed. And sunglasses still on for the event.
Word inside.
So, you know, your boy was lit for this. And then what do we do after? Oh, I met up with Eve. Kate, your bro, KP was a ghost.
Word.
For this NXT event. Oh, you weren't even in there?
No, I showed up to NXT. I took a picture of Eve with the red on, sent it to y'all. And was just like, I can't make it down these steps. Like, I will pass out. And that's why I was just like, one of y'all can go sit in that seat. Like, I didn't know if they had like collectible chairs. So that's why I was just like, go sit in that seat before somebody like steal the chair.
I wish I went over there now. Knowing that,
I checked them chairs wasn't collected. It was just regular black chairs.
Oh, it was just the drink and drinks.
Yeah,
yeah.
Wasn't nothing special.
Damn. I paid for a chair. That price was crazy. Damn.
No, it wasn't nothing crazy.
So, you know, NXT was all right, though. Like, all the matches pretty cool.
That's a fact.
Huh?
Feel me?
Guys.
Shouts to the homies. Shouts to Graham, CJ, Public Enemies. Linked up with him. Yo, literally, as soon as I walked in, Graham called me. He FaceTimed me. He was like, yo, where you at? I'm like, bro, I literally just walked into the spot. Like, so, all right. So, here's my, all right, Saturday morning, wake up, boom, refreshed. Take a shower. My girl, she pulls up. My like, right, bet we out. We driving to Philly. Boom, stopping in Jersey somewhere. Get some Chick-fil-A. So Shorty's like, yo, get me a sausage, egg and cheese biscuit, and the chick mini. So I'm like, all right, bet, cool.
Good eats.
You feel me, bro? I order it. They taking forever. I go back up there. I'm like, yo, what's the rush? So I got somewhere to be. I got to hit the turnpike. Shorty's like, yo, there's no more biscuits. I'm like,
bad eats.
Yo, put that shit on a egg McMuffin, nigga, and get me out of here, bro. Like, y'all niggas holding me up for a biscuit? I'm like, come on now. And at this point, they already switched the menu from breakfast to lunch.
Oh, my God.
I'm like, I'm not even the same shit no more, bro. You going to give me a spicy chicken deluxe? I was like, yo, hook me up. Make some moves or something. Put this shit on brioche. I don't give a damn. You know what I'm saying? So they put it on a McMuffin or whatever it is. So we get it. Now we out. Shorty comes back in the whip. She's tight. She's like, yo, some little girl was in the bathroom coughing crazy with her hands. And I was like, what you mean? She was like, the girl was just coughing. Like, her mom wasn't saying nothing. Bro, literally, as soon as she said that, the little girl walked past coughing like the wild COVID cough. So I'm like, when I tell you Shorty's coughing like Arthur Morgan boy from Red Dead Redemption, so I'm like, Shorty walked by. Shorty was like, I was like, yo, hell man. We gotta get out of here, bro. You got a tuberculosis cough, man. We gotta get out of here, son. Yo, we get in the car, we back in the turnpike. We get to Philly in like an hour. Cool.
Oh boy.
You feel me? Turn into Wells Fargo. Shorty, you feel, we get to about the park. Shorty's like, yo, it's 35 for the park. And I'm like, all right, cool, whatever. Boop, tap the little shit. They give me the receipt. Park, walk right into the spot. They don't check me for nothing. I really could have
brought it. They do this.
Nah, they didn't do nothing, bro. They was like, y'all here for the event? I was like, yeah. What else am I here for, nigga? Like, I look like I'm here to work? The fuck?
Like, bro.
Nah, by the way, they have like these new metal detectors that it like basically scans your whole body when you walk.
They got the airport joints.
Yeah, so that's how they knew that we had the flags in our pocket. They were like, nah, what is that?
That's the shoe. You gotta go in and do this shit.
They were like, take your belts off, hold it up, and walk through. And I'm like, all right, fam. I felt like a champion doing it though.
I ain't do none of that shit. I walked in. I was like, yo, you here for the show? I was like, hell yeah, I'm here for the show. Because I right this way, sir. I was like, bet. Good looks. Walked in. They didn't check nothing. They was like, yo, where's your seats? Like, they scanned the shit. And it was like, I bet your seats are right this way. Literally, I walk right into the spot, walk right down the steps. It was row 2, had good seats. The show was about to start. I think the first match was Braun Breaker. It was a tag match. Axiom, yeah. Nathan Frazier versus Braun Breaker and Corbin.
That shit went up.
Hell yeah. You know what I'm saying? Sat down. I didn't even get to sit down all the way because I seen Braun in the ring. He was doing his thing. I started barking as soon as I, feel me, entered the spot. So the show was lit, man. I didn't go crazy with the drinks. So I was like, man, I gotta be alert.
You feel me? Dial in.
Hell yeah. In case niggas with dirt bikes try to pop up on me, I gotta be on point. So I only had one brewski, which was cool. And then, yeah, you know what I'm saying? But, yeah, overall, the show was ill. NXT, great show, great environment. You know what I'm saying? The crowd was lit. I was able to get my Trini flag through. You know what I'm saying? So
even waved it.
Hell, yeah. I threw it up. Feel me? Trick Williams came out. Honestly, any reason I had to put my flag up in there, I did. I had a flag off of somebody across the stadium. I had my Trini flag. He had a Canadian flag. And we was dueling back and forth. It was ill. Nah, you know what I'm saying?
The lady confiscated all of our flags and then took it to guest services.
That's whack.
Yeah. That shit actually blew mine. But what I'm trying to remember what I did before. Oh. Eve brought me back to the Airbnb, held it down, went back to the Airbnb, pre-gamed a little bit there, went back, because we needed to collect the jackets, because we thought ahead, we were like, nah, we in Philly, beginning of April, cannot go to WrestleMania with just a hoodie on. So we went back, got all of our jackets, you know, held it down for the group. We go to Mania, scan through, we're drinking now. The bevs is flowing. Mania Night 1 happens. Cold as hell. And I don't know. I saw like a lot of things online that said like the crowd sounded dead. But it sounded alive to me. I don't know.
So the cold, that was a real thing. It wasn't like exaggerated. It was really, really cold out there.
It wasn't even just cold. I don't know if it's because of the way the arena is built or the stadium. It felt like the wind was going down, like from the stadium. So going down from the top through the stadium out. Because when we left the stadium later, there wasn't a breeze like that. Yeah, no breeze like that. Nothing crazy. But in there, bro, it was a constant breeze for the entirety of the event. I was absolutely freezing cold. But I had my North Face, so I was chilling.
Yeah, it was Saturday. It was brick. So brick. Well, I had really good seats. Got them super late, but sat ringside row 3. And just the cold, man. Like, it had me regretting venturing out. But thankfully, midway through the show, like, there was a heating rig, something that Eve probably built above the ring. And they, like, turned that motherfucker to max, boy. And, like, everybody around us was just like, yeah, yeah. Like, we wasn't cheering for the match. They turned the heat up, and, like, we could feel it. And but later on through the night, as that wind was doing whatever it was doing, and, like, they tossed us blankets and shit. And by that point, like, I'm just wrapped up in a blanket, leaned back in my chair. Kaz is sitting beside me, and we're just enjoying the show. And
y'all was wrapped up together?
Nah, pause.
Oh.
See, look at Maddie, man.
Bro, do y'all see this luxury lifestyle he was living? I'm in the 100s, freezing. He's getting blankets thrown at him by the WWE. Like, yo, here you go.
Y'all should have done like I was in the crib cooling like this.
Some chicken wings.
I seen them heat lamps too. I was like, I forgot what match it was, but like they showed like the top of the thing, and I was like, they had heating lamps the whole time. I was like, I guess they had them there for the wrestlers themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but they strong, they work. But y'all lucky it wasn't some damn like 30 degree 40. If it was 40 degrees, like low 40s, y'all probably would have been screwed. You know what I'm saying? But
I think it was. Well,
I'm about to say low, Saturday it was.
Saturday, yeah, I think it was like low 30s.
Yeah, it was low 30s. Saturday, Sunday, it warmed up.
I think it was 40 in the daytime. Yeah. It was cold on Saturday, really cold.
I seen Michael Cole in the North Face shiesty. I was like, they gotta be cold. Nigga, exactly. Shiesty in a tuxedo. I was like,
yeah, man, had it pulled over the headsets.
Yeah, unlike KP, my boys, because I had the parka, so I was good. It was a big ass North Face parka. Mm-hmm. My boys had to buy shirts from the concession stands just to like wear them as like some earmuffs, like a little scarf, because it was that cold.
Yeah.
So they need to, you know,
and like me, I would have bought mad alcohol to warm up.
I was drunk. I was drunk by. I'm trying to remember. The matches.
See, I
was that drunk. Exactly. I don't even remember the matches in a match order, but I was lit. So that was night one. Night two, you know, we were invited to the Big E's Big Brunch. It was a brunch catered for minority creatives in the wrestling field. So, you know, podcasts like us, you know, Stat Guy Greg was there, the Ringers Wrestling Podcast, everybody from the Ringer over there, Armand was there, Jeff J was there. You know, it was a lot of great creatives. You know, not even just, you know, black and brown, great black and brown creatives, but they're just top of the wrestling world creatives. And you know, it was a beautiful brunch. It was you know, nice bar situation, couple free drinks.
How was the catfish?
Oh my god. So yeah, you know, I'm at this point, I'm maybe like 7 drinks in.
Nice.
You know, it's the thing, it started at 10 a.m. I got there around like 10:30-ish, maybe 10:20. So, you know, I had the food, but I'm not a big fish guy. So a couple drinks. It's towards the end of the event. It's maybe like 1 o'clock, 1:30. Jeff J, see him eating. He's like, yo, this catfish. He takes like a bite. He's like, yo, this is the best catfish I've ever had in my life. At least top 3. I go, yo, that's a bold claim to just say on a random Sunday.
Facts.
So he gives me a piece. I'm not a fish guy. I do not like fish. This catfish is one of the greatest things I've ever had. Not even just like fish. It's one of the best things I've ever eaten. So we're sitting there. We're all now. Everybody's getting catfish, and everybody's agreeing about it. So,
wait, it was free.
It was free. The food was free.
Boy, y'all lucky. Y'all would have been that.
Platter would have been gone.
Nah, I was. Listen, we were eating swell. Everybody had a solid size plate. There was a lot of networking happening there. You know, a lot of everybody that that knew who I was. Or whenever I introduced myself, they would be like, oh, you know, where's Eve? Where's Cody? You know, where's everybody else? I let them know Cody, you know. Cody missed all the Mania activities because his pet hamster was giving birth and he had to be there for it. So, you know, I had to, you know, let the people know. Eve, I told him, yo, he just pulled up for Mania. Pulled up for NXT, couldn't, you know, be a part of this. So I told him Eve was building a pool somewhere. You know, an above ground pool somewhere. And then I let them know KP was a ghost. KP is just there whenever he needs to, and he'll know he's there. We won't.
At least you made us look ill. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Appreciate it.
Well, it was great. It was great that everybody was like, you know, everybody knew who we were in a sense. Like, there was a couple people who didn't know, but I don't want to say I was shocked, but I was. It was great to see people be like, oh, where is, you know, so-and-so? So it was a cool feeling. It made me think, I'm like, yo, next year, my God, we got to make this like a thing, you know, make sure, you know, we pop out to things like this. Cause, you know, listen, the people love us. And it's a great feeling.
You know, people do love. I was getting calls and texts from Thursday, like, yo, where you at? You going to be here? I'm like, bro, I'm watching the Knicks game right now. You're interrupting. This is a sweat. Yo, please. I'll get back to you in an hour and a half.
Yeah. So, and bro, I'm telling you, like, bro, I'm walking around in like arenas and stuff like that. Wherever, like, we went to all these wrestling events and stuff like that, bro, people dabbing me up, telling me, yo, I know you from the Black Announcing. But I'm like, I did not expect that to be a thing at all this entire week. And I thought it was just going to be like low key. You know, maybe see a couple people that, like, you know, I actually know that listen. But it was just, like, some random people that I don't have a personal relationship being like, oh, I know you from the show. So that was a really cool feeling. You guys will definitely love it if we ever pop out to one of these big fours and make a thing of it. But, you know, started networking, you know, drinks is flowing. Now, you know, 17 dap-ups every time I'm talking to somebody. You know, giving motivational speeches, things like that. It was a great event, to be honest. You know, they said that they want to make this, you know, a multiple occurrence. So they don't want it to just be the first one. It's the first of many. It's not just the only one. So Big E, unfortunately, couldn't be there because they needed him everywhere Mania week. So it was a great, great event. You guys definitely got to make it out to one of these. Got to make sure that's a thing. So, let me see. I went to the WrestleMania World, did my entrance. I did the whole DX entrance with my boy.
Y'all was lit with that.
Listen, so Mania World, WWE World, I think is what it's called. This is the new, like, Access.
Yeah.
Is it the same shit as Access, or is it like?
Yeah, they just rebranded it because their big event in Saudi Arabia is called WWE World as well. So they just brought this here. They had Triple H's WrestleMania 30 entrance piece. They had the In Your House. Right here, you're looking at, if you're watching on YouTube, all of The Rock's $500 shirts from back in the day. They had like a 2K station where you can play with different other, you know, play the game with different people. They had the NXT In Your House set that you could walk through. They had Bray Wyatt's Funhouse and his door that you could take pictures in and walk through. Look at that. They had Stone Cold's boots and vest from WrestleMania 13. Just incredible pieces and parts of WWE history that who even thought they kept. As a nerd and a collector, I knew they kept. But like the average person was like losing their mind seeing this stuff.
I was just about to say, like, I know you're a big like memorabilia guy, so I'm sure you seeing this shit, you was probably like
trying to sneak off with the shoes.
You took the Triple H crown. I thought you took the Triple H crown.
Nah, they would have had me hemmed up.
They could try to replace it with a Burger King crown. Same thing.
He's Nicolas Cage. That entrance thing was the best part.
Yeah, I was about to say that. Did anybody? So when I was there, you kept hearing Cody's theme and people who were dressed up exactly like Cody Rhodes doing the entrance. But one of the funnier things was when someone did Kurt Angle's entrance and the crowd actually chanted, "You suck."
Yeah.
And I thought that was really dope.
Listen, everybody was picking the same, you know, Bloodline, Cody Rhodes, CM Punk.
CM Punk, yeah.
And some Stone Colds, you know, sprinkled here and there. But I'd never want to hear the Cody Rhodes theme song ever again. Next time he comes out, like on a TV show or anything like that, I'm muting the TV. I heard Cody's theme song minimum 30 times just standing on that line waiting to do my DX entrance.
And they're playing music over top of all of it. Most of the time they're playing fucking Cody Rhodes theme. So it's just nonstop Cody. Yeah.
Between Cody Rhodes' theme song and what was the weekend song that they played?
Oh,
Gasoline. Bro, I loved Gasoline before it was the Mania theme song. And now I never want to hear that song ever again for the rest of my life.
I love that shit. I don't care.
Bro, they played it in the stadium on night one. They played it in the stadium on night one at least minimum, no lie, 50 times.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody counted, it'd be like 23 times they played that song. Easy. Bro. 23 times. And it's not like previous years where it's multiple themes. Nah, it was just this over and over. But
I'm surprised they didn't play Meek in the stadium.
They did to start off Mania.
You want to talk about Meek? Oh, well, I guess. You got his tweet, Cody?
Oh, I got it right here. My nigga said, that's supposed to be WrestleMania. Was more fun than I expected. Thank you, WWE, for the link up.
I'm not even going to hold you. Somebody's going to name their kid Wasanya Dior.
And it's liked by Bobby Shmurda.
You know, Bobby Shmurda is the only person that read it as WrestleMania.
Word.
Him and Fabio Foreign.
For sure.
Fabio Foreign sees nothing wrong with this sense.
Yo, Fabio, if you leave it up to Fabio Foreign, he'll spell WWE wrong.
Damn.
He'll spell out the letter W.
Word.
Yo, but so after the the brunch, I went to WrestleMania World or whatever it's called. That was pretty lit. I tried getting tatted, but all the tattoo people were all booked up and everything like that. Yeah. So Eve told me while I was waiting, like looking around for people, he's like, "I don't know if that's a great idea. I don't think you're allowed to do that when you're drunk." I was like, "That's the only time you're supposed to do it."
I was like, "Yeah, I think you bleed out when you drink and get a tattoo, but
yeah,
what do I know?"
So we do WrestleMania Night 2, and bro, WrestleMania Night 1, it was great because it was like, bro, it's our collectively in our group, there was six of us, it was all of our first Mania, so it was just cool off rip that it was our first Mania. But Night 2 was like one of the greatest nights I've ever had, like anywhere, going to any event. Like every match was a banger. The main event that we're gonna get into later, we were fucking screaming the entire time. We're drinking too, so everything's even better. And then we leave Mania, and we end up going to the bars across the street. And there's this one bar that we were like waiting for this other bar, and the lines were too long. So we look in a window, and we're like, we see like a bunch of people dancing and stuff like that. And then there's a mechanical bull. We just look and go right in there, bro. No lines waiting for alcohol, anything like that. So we're like, oh, it's lit. I drank minimum, like, I want to say it was like 7 double tequila pineapples in these like big ass cups that they had. And yeah, you know, I was lit and I was like, damn, you know, we'll go crazy right now. Some Cash Cobain. I walk over to the DJ booth. I'm like, yo, sir, I need a favor from you. You got that Cash Cobain? I need to hear, and I show him the song. I'm like, I need to hear for sure. So he's like, yeah, I got you. And I'm like, bro, and I'm lit. So like, I'm a little, you know, I'm on edge. I'm like, bro, don't tell me you got me and you're not going to play it. I was like, yo, if you're not going to play it, tell me right. Look me in my eyes and tell me you're not going to play it. He's like, no, I got you. So I walk away, and then all you hear is the beginning of CM Punk's theme song. He's like, and he points at me. I look at him. I'm like, I should jump this DJ booth and just strangle this man.
That's not fire, though?
Or...
Nah. It was super weird, because then he got into his bag of playing theme songs.
Oh, God.
Bro, because it was like the bars across the street from the stadium. So it was nothing but wrestling fans, and then there was like dancers. Literally. But there was like,
I'm there was like,
get up.
That was 113. I edit that out.
So there's these dancers, ooh, that are like dancing on these like stages type thing, and all these wrestling fans, bro. You would think it's the first time they've ever talked to like a woman ever in their life. Bro, they just wouldn't stop like heckling these dances and stuff like that. So
that's the only bad thing about wrestling fans right there. Some of you wrestling fans, you guys, man,
just chill out,
bro. This, chill, listen, bro. I'm not even gonna hold you though. There wasn't that many women in the spot to begin with. So, and these dances are all beautiful.
Not have to say that. Bro, that we know.
They were all like, five valid, you know, or maybe it was just a Philadelphia 10, but a New York, you know, 4. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Damn.
No, I'm just playing.
That's OD, 4 is crazy.
I'm just kidding. But oh, so we were there with, there was two girls that we knew that were, they were there hanging out with us. But I'm like, yo, these dudes are like hyenas. Like, you, they'll, every couple seconds another guy comes up trying to talk to one of the girls that we were with. I'm like, geez, guys, like, I want to break. But you know, being in a club or a bar with a bunch of wrestling fans, it wasn't not fun, but it wasn't fun. Like, if it wasn't because I was completely hammered, I would have been tight. I would have been stressed out.
CM Punk.
Yes, because there was one guy dressed as CM Punk. So there was a mechanical bull in the middle of the club. And like, some people were dressed as wrestlers. So whenever somebody would dress like a wrestler would get on the bull, everybody, woo, was standing. And I'm like, bruh.
Manny, the listeners want to know, did you get on the mechanical bull?
I 100% got on the mechanical bull.
If, insert the video here.
If, cue the drop. And please send the video, man.
Nah, I already got the footage.
Nah.
I'm sending it.
Lucky the drop not working, man.
Aww. Good.
Get up!
Crazy.
Yo, let me tell you, bro. There was this one dude. He had to be like maybe... he was like maybe like 5... like 5'6". 260 pounds, just a round dude. Maybe he was a little bit taller, but he was a really big, heavy set dude. He jumped up to try to get on the bull, fell off, did two backflips, and he bounced out of the pool thing, like wherever the bull was. He fell backwards and flipped backwards twice out of the fucking bull arena, I want to call it. Bro, it was the funniest thing I've ever seen in my entire life.
Old ball looked at that nigga.
Get up!
But, oh my God, bro. I was crying. I've never seen somebody, like, he flew backwards because it was like, you know, like a bounce house type of thing where it's like super bouncy, pause. So he was so big that the momentum just flew him out of the fucking thing, and he flew over a little wall onto the wooden floor.
Yo, that's crazy.
Yo, I've seen a lot of like people that shouldn't ever even try to get on that bull. It was pretty sad. There was one dude who he kept trying. He tried 15 times, never made it on the bull once. And listen, man. That one I actually felt bad for. It stopped being funny after like the sixth try, and I was like, damn, somebody get this guy on the bull. Oh, man, but yeah, that nightclub was pretty lit. Philadelphia sucks for everything closing at 2 a.m., though. That was pretty whack. I definitely wanted to keep the party going, but
Philly don't strike me as a place that got like, it don't strike me as like a nightlife place. Cause like, yeah, even the video I seen with Damian Priest in the club with a bottle of Ace of Spades, I was like, club looked kind of empty. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is the world heavyweight champion. This nigga, it's just him with a bottle of Ace and his championship, dancing the fucking dreams and nightmares and shit.
Meek Mill with his sunglasses down, look, checking him out.
Damn, I don't even know what to play for that.
Word.
Anyways. Yeah, nah. Philly don't strike me as the nightlife type of place anyways, but overall, it sounded like niggas had a great time, man. KP, yeah. I think your experience was different because, you know, you have bread.
Yeah, now tell us about the Rich experience.
Yeah, what? You were sitting next to Winnie Harlow. Yo, this nigga KP tried to flex. He was like, I don't even call her Winnie. I got a special name for her.
Yeah, like we go back to when she was on For Y'all Entertainment videos, like early 2010s, before she became this big supermodel and all this stuff like that. So,
like,
And all this stuff like that.
You know, I mean, she was there. She got, I'm looking at this video. She, when I say good
back,
huh?
Nah, you was like, we go back. Do you really know her? You bullshit.
I don't know her, you know what I'm saying? But I know of her from back in the day.
Oh, like us.
But she reacted to me saying like, oh no, I know you from.
Oh, from For Y'all?
Yeah, For Y'all Entertainment. It's some comedians.
From Canada, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
And so she looked over and was just like, oh, wow. You know what I'm saying? So I just sent like some videos to the DXC Twitter.
Yeah.
But yeah, so night one, I was sitting ringside, row three, like I said. And they gave us like these wristbands, and the wristband was just to let security know, like, hey, these folks are supposed to be in this section and they can go to this section.
Right.
And so at the end of the show, you know, there's a bunch of high profile people sitting in front of me, but I really didn't care about that. I'm just enjoying WrestleMania. I'm enjoying talking to Kaz, listening to Kaz more so. And, at the end of the night, I get my chair, and since it was sort of empty right there, I got two chairs. So I let that whole section clear out like for 30 minutes. People were just ravaging all the chairs. Then a dad walks by with a kid. He looking all sad. And he like, you gonna sell a chair? I was like, yeah. $250. All right, cool. Boom. So I sell that chair. I had no plans on taking that chair out of there. So I was just sitting right there waiting for someone to ask. That worked out great. Boom.
Swag.
Nice.
Man, so, easy $250.
Easy. And it wasn't even It's a easy. It's completely free money. So
y'all, if the pops came up to me like, yo, you selling that child? I'm like, yeah, $10 million.
Of course.
One of my homies was just like, you should have asked for 400, but I'm like, bro, 250. I didn't even pay for that seat. You know what I'm saying?
So, word.
And free I money. Get to keep my chair. Like, I wasn't gonna walk out carrying two chairs, so it worked. So speaking of carrying two chairs, I didn't even really want to walk that far back up all them fucking steps. And so I started to see like where the high profile people were going. And I was just like, I'm following them. Like, I put my shades on, threw my blanket around my neck. And so I just started following Travis Kelce.
And wait, did anybody else see that in KP's apartment or house?
What?
The name you dropped.
Oh, get out of here. Okay, I'm not so Mouse. Good. I'm not get Mouse. I'm not Mouse.
Travis Kelce.
Yeah, nah, you and Mouse leading the league. And is you? No, nah, it's definitely.
Is Mouse?
You, it's Mouse, you, and then Manny for name drops.
For sure.
I don't even be name dropping people y'all know. I'll be like, yo.
Manny be name dropping the week.
The D-tier niggas.
Yeah, so it was me and 22 G's the other day.
I'm like, Manny, please don't tell niggas we hung out with these niggas. Like, no, but we got to let them know for context.
We got to let them know.
Look what we got.
Come on, it's K-Fly.
Word.
And so I just follow, you know, the football player. And I just sent some videos to the Twitter. And so I'm just standing off in the cut. Like, I know, well, that's the thing. That brand, I won't say what color, but the brand, well, I already told Twitter, it was a pink wristband. It allowed me to go back there. So I'm just standing in a cut. One of the first people I see was Ref Charles Robinson, Lil Nate. So shout out to him. He was just like, you know, good job. Appreciate you. So the second person I see is the main event final boss himself. Matter of fact, he's the first person I see. Charles Robinson was the second. Wow. So The Rock literally walks past me.
Oh, I got the video right here. I got it right here.
And it's really? Two Rock videos. It may be that second. Oh, it may be the first one, I think. That's the second time when he's coming back in. And I sort of just walked with him and walked back into the stadium. Go up to that first one.
This one right here?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So this is when I first get back there.
Great job, champ.
Champ.
What were you going to call him the first time? You going to call him people's champ?
Call him a nigga.
I mean, he got that fantasy belt, so he the champ, you know?
Wait, what's this one right here?
Oh, that's champ, when I told Cody Dre.
Don't get him tomorrow, Seth. Big time! I love you, Matthew!
That was you, right? That was you screaming that?
Yeah, that was me screaming. And so, yeah, just a few little videos. It was several legends walking back there. Oh, that first video was Manny Wilder.
No way.
Oh. I know you're already up. Oh, no. I know you're already up. Oh, no.
Seen that back body drop, though?
This nigga Manny wild out, son.
And so, yeah, man, like, it was several legends that walked past. DDP, X-Pac, several legends. I just shouted them out, got little quick little videos. And yeah, so that's how I ended my night one, just backstage. And I could have went to the press conference, but it was just like, I don't care about that. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not one of you, you know, one of you guys, like, where you're the face of all of what we do, or you can go represent us. It was just like, nah, like, I got the Rock video exclusive little clip right here. So I'm good. I'm about to go post that on our YouTube.
Hell yeah.
So,
wow, man, that's dope.
That's amazing. When I saw the videos, I'm sitting there, I'm like, how the, I thought KP was gonna sit in like the 100s or something like that with me. He posted a video of where he was. I was like, all right, bro, I guess.
You know who KP is?
Bro, I ain't no, my fault.
Big time.
my fault, OG. I didn't know that was your game. Once he was like, yo, I think Lil Baby sitting in front of me. I'm like, why would Lil Baby be sending the hundreds?
Word.
And he sent the picture. I'm like,
peasant. That's peasant talk right there.
So, oh, you literally be sitting behind Michael Cole.
Yeah. I'm like, bro.
Man, I can only imagine that was an experience, man. I know you had a ball.
Incredible experience. And it was just like, you know, I wanted to see The Rock wrestle for real. Like, I saw him at WrestleMania 32, but that really wasn't a match. So it was just like, this may be the only opportunity. They may be in fucking Minnesota next year, which I'm never going to. Shout out to our Minnesota listeners. But I'm never going there. But yeah, so it was just like, this is perfect. It's 2 hours away. I bought a ticket a few weeks back and, you know, flipped it. But so yeah, that was my night one, which was really dope. Really blessed to be able to do that. Night two, I sat row 7-8 or something like that. So it was a little bit further back.
My fault. But yeah, too far. You need the binoculars.
Yeah, I needed that, you know. And but it was a straight ahead shot. So they were performing right for the camera. That's where I was sitting. And but that night I was super chill. Like I came in the arena when Drew was losing his belt. Walked down the steps. I had 3 bottles of water, and I told Ethan Manny this earlier. So had 3 bottles of water to make sure I'm hydrated throughout this show. As I reached like the floor section, the guy's just like, oh, you can't bring those bottles down here. So he like takes my water, pours them in cups. So I'm now holding 3 fucking
full cups of water.
3 cups of water. And so I'm walking to my seat. I see Manny Girl, Jakar Jackson. They playing Snoop Dogg on the joint. I'm feeling good, you know what I'm saying? So I'm like dancing and feeling good to my, you know what I'm saying? So I wave to Jakar.
Now you 2-stepping in front of her?
I was.
Legend.
You know? And I sit in my seat and reach down to pick up one of them bottles, the cups of water. All 3 of them shits knocked over. So I'm like,
man,
fuck it.
L.
Big L.
It's down.
That's what you get. That's karma.
Yeah.
All right. Watch a 2-step.
I would have looked at the mortars like,
get up!
And so, you know, night 2 was lit. You know what I'm saying? Like, night 1 was cool. Like, it was calm. It did what it needed to do. But night 2, man, like, I felt like when the Bailey match kicked off, a lot of people were sleeping on that. But they went out there and went crazy. And, like, that's when the crowd really woke up. That's when my section really woke up. And night 2 was really awesome. And that was my WrestleMania. Like, I kept it low key, even though I was in like little places.
And little places.
I wasn't ghosting people purposely. I was sick. So yeah. But I had an amazing time. I don't think I'll ever be able to do that again. And so that's why I went all out.
Look, man, I ain't gonna hold you. Black Announce Table, you heard it here. We had the on the scene reporters, the recap and all of that, man. You know what I'm saying? We got to give it up for ourselves for that, man. That's a that's fire right there, man. Right in front of the action.
Yeah.
Man. Niggas can't top the A, man. Shit sounded phenomenal from what I heard. Next time, I want to go to WrestleMania and sit where KP sat. You know what I'm saying? Like, I want to sit by Winnie Harlow and Drewski too. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I don't want to be in the one. I mean, I could do that too. You got to sit in the 100 sometimes just to, you got to be amongst the people. But that's what I like about, you feel me, what KP and Manny did. You know what I'm saying? We covered all bases. Mm-hmm. You feel me? Me and Manny hit NXT. You feel me? Then they both went to night one and two of WrestleMania. KP was with the rich people and Manny was amongst the people. And we was all, you know what I'm saying? It's lit.
Every aspect, man.
Yeah.
I even went to the Raw after Mania too.
Come on, man. Raw after Mania. Big E brunch. Like, the bases was definitely covered this weekend.
I'm not even going to hold you. I'm not saying this just because it happened. It was legit probably one of the greatest, like, weekends I've ever had in my entire life. Like, definitely, you know, like a top five. Yeah, where I'm like, yo, everything was so much fun. Had a blast. You know, it was a group trip. So, you know, me and the guys just, it was two people I went with that I didn't even know before the trip. And now we're all, like, you know, locked in. We're all boys, you know, shit like that. So. Like, it's my first Mania, and it was honestly one of the, like, the greatest times I've ever had, like, ever. And I've done a lot of shit, but it's like, this was, you know, as a lifelong wrestling fan and shit like that, doing something like this was absolutely incredible.
And to think about it, bro, the Mania, the your very first Mania was record-breaking, history-making, honestly, it's considered one of the best Manias, if not the best Mania ever. So
easy. I've been to 10 of them. Night two.
Yeah.
It's not even close.
I'm not gonna lie. And it definitely looked the way you guys saying it's some of the best times you had. It came off that way. I'm watching, I'm like, fam, they look like they having a ball. Some of these pictures y'all got, your interactions with the celebrities and everything. Manny, he got some. The dope pictures, just him and his boys out there, like everything, son. Everything, it definitely looks like you guys are having the time of y'all lives.
Yeah. You know, it was cool. You know, nobody, you know, it's not like a rap concert that you go to and you're like, it's all on the performer. So you're, most people that go to concerts, they're like trying to have a cool off. Like they just, you know, trying to look cool around everybody else. Like, bro, you could sing an entire theme song when you're walking somewhere and people are going to, you know, join in with you. You can say random phrases and shit like that, and people are gonna repeat it right back to you in big groups during the entire match. You can cheer and boo and all these things, and people aren't gonna be like, "Oh, this person is wild." And, like, you know, it was a really fun time. Like, it was like what this Mania felt like is like what wrestling should be all the time.
The vibe, the aura, the mana.
Yeah, exactly, bro. I'm getting chills just thinking about it right now.
All weekend long, man.
Bro, the amount of times that me and my boys did the arm slap all weekend, bro. At least 300 times, no cap.
You got, bro, when the mana's flowing and the goosebumps get going, you got to let people know, man.
You got to do it.
But now all of this... And honestly, and I really hope WrestleMania is not in Minnesota next year. You feel me? God bless the great state of Minnesota, but
no, bro.
At the same time, God, please, let's figure something out. I'm not trying to go.
I do think that, like, this Mania being so cold,
yeah,
maybe helps the case for future, like the next Mania, because I saw Nick Khan was sitting ringside. Mm-hmm. You know, Triple H was there. They know how fucking freezing cold everybody was.
That nigga Nick Khan was like,
what? Yeah, like, no, really. Like, he kept leaving and walking back. Like, yeah, hot cocoa and shit. So it was just like, he realized how cold it was.
So I feel like maybe next year, you know, if they do it in Vegas or wherever the fuck, hopefully, you know, they're putting it in a warmer climate just for next year. Before going to Minnesota the year after or something like that, because I mean, the money is going to be the money. You know, it's not like Minnesota is going to offer $1 billion more than Vegas or something like that. You know, the money is going to be the money. So, you know, just as a little thank you for showing up. Hey, don't freeze your balls off. for an entire WrestleMania week?
WrestleMania, besides Vegas, there's two places off the top of my head that WrestleMania should be. One, Miami. We love the Yams. You feel me?
Facts.
And I mean that more ways than one. You feel me? And two, New Orleans. And I know we've been to New Orleans a bunch of times. WrestleMania, but WrestleMania New Orleans, when I tell you, brother, the mana, come on, bro. Everything you need is in New Orleans, bro. Good eats, good music, good drinks. You feel me? Everything is right there. And honestly, things aren't that far from each other in New Orleans.
Like, that part. That's the biggest part, because everything in New Orleans is 15 minutes away.
Yeah,
so you don't have to Uber everywhere. It's just everything is in a triangle. It's right. Walking distance. It's perfect. And
you hop on the little trolley, you feel me? Take the trolley this way, you feel me?
But I don't, now that I think about it, I think it's good that I had a curfew. Because everything closed at 2 a.m., we had to go home. You know what I'm saying? Except for the last night, we were out till like 5 because we were keeping it going. But, you know, things closing early, at least, you know, it gets people right for the next day. You know, if I'm in a New Orleans or a Miami or a Vegas, my God.
Yeah, it's over.
My God. This will be an in memoriam for Manny podcast right now.
Bro. I can't even think about Vegas, bro. Vegas niggas, I'm like, yo, are you going to be at Mania night one? I'm like, yeah, Mania, right? Yeah, I got my ticket right here. Nigga, I show niggas a $100 poker chip. He's like, bro, this says Bellagio. Yeah, tomato, tomato.
Bro, I'm gonna put my ticket on the craps table. Like, yo, y'all accept this?
That's a fact. Eve shit gone.
It's yes.
Like, bro, this is
so is this show.
He's selling it. He's Word. Selling KP. Hey KP, I sold your soul. My fault. You work for the Mondrian now.
Oh shit. Man. Shouts to the Philly niggas on dirt bikes outside of whoever's crib.
You hear it, right?
You feel me? But let's touch night one and two of Mania, man. Let's recap these joints.
I'm back. Let me hit this music.
Go ahead.
It's WrestleMania!
All right, let's fucking pod.
Let's do it, man.
Let's do it, man. WrestleMania night one. Now, look, supposed to have the recap. Well, we did have a recap, but I was supposed to join. Yeah, man. I let the people down on that one, man. My Wi-Fi is going crazy. I don't
you
know.
You and J. Cole.
Yeah, man. Sad things. Sad things. You feel me? But my boy Eve held it down. You know what I'm saying?
It was interesting. I tapped in. Because we were walking to the car or whatever. So I was like, you know what? Let me see how the post game show is going. I tab in. I see it's Eve, and I was like, yo, he's holding it down right now. Because I saw in the chat that you were saying you were having the technical difficulties. So I wanted to see like what kind of show Eve would have.
Nigga thought it was just gonna be me like this.
Nah, I was just, you know, it was because not a lot of people can pull off just a one person show.
Yeah.
And for you to do what you did that day, amazing job. You held it down.
Hold on, man. Let's give him a hold on. For the people, you know what I'm saying? Just for the people.
Yeah. But Legend. I mean, I had some pushback because, you know, you were saying some bullshit unchecked. So now's the time.
Oh, and look, man, I'm, you know, things happen for a reason, because I would have came in on the post show, man. And I'm gonna bring up the card, man. I wasn't feeling night one. Well, obviously, my Wi-Fi played a big part in that. I was watching some of the matches off the phone. from here and there because my Wi-Fi was going in and out. Mm. I was seeing them on the phone. Wingstop forgot my drink. Bussing. Like I was already in a I wasn't at my happiest. You know what I'm saying? I'll leave it at that. I had to look into the camera and talk to the people. I wasn't at my happiest. So you know what I'm saying? But as time goes on, I feel the same exact way. You know what I'm saying? I just wasn't feeling night one like that. And Manny, I'm gonna start with Manny. How you feel about night one?
All right, so I'm gonna take you through the progressions of how I was feeling in real time. So it started with this is all in order, right?
Yeah, it looks like it.
Okay, it's in order.
I was hitting the
that's all right. It's all good. So Rhea and Becky. When this match came on, I'm sitting there and I'm like, oh my God. It's WrestleMania. We're finally here. That's how I felt. Match number two, I was like, okay, this is going to be like a low-key banger. We're all going to love it. We're going to have a great time. And then, you know, the match happens and it was cool. But did it feel like WrestleMania? Not really. For this match, match number three, I was sitting there and I was like, eh, I guess, you know, it's all right. Jimmy and Jey Uso. I've never been so underwhelmed by anything in my entire life. I was so sad when that match finished because me and all my boys were just sitting there and we went, how does that happen? We were sitting there and we're like, bro, it's like the Young Bucks were the producers of this match.
So it came off that way in person is what you're telling me.
It was very underwhelming, bro. I'm telling you, it ended, and everybody, at least around me, were just like, all right, cool. That happened. But it felt like WrestleMania all over again when Jade, Bianca, Naomi faced Damage Control. That's when, like, the energy started building back up. Now everybody's, you know, tapped in. Everybody was, like, having a really good time during this match. People chanting, clapping, everything like that. Now we're getting back into it. Sammy and Gunther was as WrestleMania as it gets.
Yeah, that was real music.
That was, well, between, because they showed all the not the video package, but, like, the backstage stuff with his family, Kevin Owens, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. That's when everybody locked the fuck back in because we knew, like, oh, there's only like two more matches. Let's go. And then for the main event, peak, bro, that match, it felt like it was bigger than any other WrestleMania match in the history of wrestling before this. Like, you felt it. Pause.
Yeah. Yeah, man, I feel you on this one. Rhea and Becky, for me, they showed up. They showed up. They did their thing. I'm not going to lie. They did. And it's crazy. They said Rhea had a panic attack before the match. And Becky was with strep and a fever over 102. I'm like, fam, and y'all going out there and performing. You know what I'm saying? I felt like it could have. It was good. Don't get me wrong. It was definitely a great way to open the show. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to go too hard on them for that. It was good. You know what I'm saying? Could it be better? It could have been. They could have reached another gear for me. You know what I'm saying? The ladder match was cool. It was cool. But like you saying, it just wasn't hitting like that for me, man. I don't know what it was, but you know what I'm saying? A-Town Down Under, they grabbed the titles, and I'm like, oh, all right. And niggas made like it was like no big deal. They became champions, like the match keep going type shit. Like,
niggas ain't care.
Word. Like, nobody gave a fuck. It's just like, oh, all right, bet.
Even after the match, I'm sitting there and I'm like, wait a minute. Why are they acting like R-Truth and The Miz won the match in totality?
Because that's what niggas cared about. Okay.
Yeah, they had some good spots in here, man. R-Truth once again doing what he doing, man, with getting the hot tag, and that was funny. I popped for that. That was cool. But yeah, once again, that wasn't really the turn up point for me. The Rey Mysterio and Andrade, they swapped out Dragon Lee for Andrade. This match, they could have did this on SmackDown.
Exactly.
Yeah, I wasn't, dude, because like I got my notes right here. I got a page full of notes. I ain't even get a chance to say none of this shit. But my wings came during this match, so it was like perfect time for me. It was like, all right, cool. So I dove into the wings on that one. Then we got to the, oh Lord, we got to the Jey Uso Jimmy Uso joint, man. And want to talk about disappointments. Man, this was not man, this was not it, man. Shout out to Lil Wayne, performed them. Jey Uso out, super kick party. This yeah, that, the least said the better on that one for me. I ain't gonna hold you on that one, man. The Jay Bianca Naomi, hey man, fire. I'ma just say fire because of those three women right there. You know, this match did everything it was supposed to do. I wasn't expecting like a classic or a really dope match out of this. This match was just to set up Jade for stardom. You know what I'm saying? It was set her. This is her WrestleMania, her in-ring debut. She's gonna go out there and shine. And that's exactly what she did for this match, man. She had the entrance with Naomi, Bianca, that was fire. And she went out there and did what Jay did. Like, she did exactly what needed to be done for this match. You know what I'm saying? So I wasn't too mad at this one. This was cool for me because, like, my expectations wasn't too high for that. Cool. Sami Zayn defeating Gunther. Like you said, before the match, Sammy with his family and everything, KO. I love that. And that's something I love. Like, it gave it like a big fight feel. It put more into the match, and it helped with that story with Gable training him and everything, and now leading up to this big moment. And I just want to say this: all it took was a brain buster and a couple haluva kicks. I ain't gonna hold you. I probably could have beat Gunther too, man. If that's all it took, like, I wish I knew. Like, no,
yeah, man. That's yeah, crazy, sick, man. You are not pulling off a brain buster, my brother. Yo, let's start in Uganda and work our way up to a brain.
Yeah, he went from getting smoked in Uganda to beating Walter.
I'm doing too much right now. All right, that's cool. But like, fam, it took a little brain buster, a couple haluva kicks, and you got the job done. For some reason, now, don't get me wrong, this match was good. For some reason, though, was Sammy the right guy to do this, though?
After seeing the match and like how it felt, pause. Yeah. Like, because I feel like Sammy, you can get a lot with his personality, his character, things like that. Like, him versus Chad Gable, everybody just wants to see Chad Gable turn on him and have them go into a program and shit like that. Or, like, even, let's say he beats Chad Gable. Sammy versus, like, a Ricochet. But, because, bro, I'm sitting there. I was sitting in Raw yesterday. I'm wondering. I'm like, yo, why don't some people, like, get anything, like any pop, anything like that from the crowd when they come out, or like why their matches feel lukewarm and shit like that. Bro, some of these people just be going out, theme music playing, have a match, win the match, and then go and then leave. And then everybody's supposed to care about them or if they lose. And that's how I felt with Ricochet yesterday, where it's like, bro, people want to like Ricochet, but there's just something missing, and it's literally just him being in a storyline where people have to give a fuck. Like the Sami Zayn thing works because he's always in a storyline where somebody has to care.
Yeah. Yeah, that's why I see what they try to do, you know what I'm saying? And the story, it's a good story, it's a feel-good story. I just feel like it could have been told better with Gable. I feel like Gable's story, for me personally, I would have wanted that more.
Do you think Gable can do more as a heel or a face?
As a face.
Yeah.
For that beating Gunther, ultimate babyface, bro.
It was set up, man. It was set up. It was set up for that, man. And I feel like with the Sammy thing, it's like they kind of.
I feel like they should have had a triple threat for that match.
But do you see like what they're doing with Sammy and
Gable?
And Gable.
Like, Sammy, he's gonna give him a crack at it, right? Pause.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, pause. But he's also like sunning them a little bit too, like in their interactions that they've been having with each other. Sammy's been, you know, acting like, you know, he won the title without Gable's help, and then Gable would like give him a look and be like, Sammy's like, oh, I mean, and you helped too, kinda. Like he's yeah, undermining him a little bit, so there. I see what y'all mean, because it's all to get to the same place. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I do think that it ends with Gable being champion, but I think they're just stretching out this the story for that to happen.
Yeah. And by the way, listeners, we just running this down real quick, because Eve gave his mm-hmm. thoughts on everything. So me and Manny, we just quickly running it down for night two. We gonna break that down more in depth together. But for the main event, the Bloodline defeating Cody Rhodes, Seth Rollins. This match went about 45 minutes, mm-hmm. and I'm not gonna hold you, man. The Rock, he got it, man. And he still looked good. It took a little while to like pick up, you know what I'm saying? But man, he came out and I just want to give him his flowers too for doing the work leading up to WrestleMania, going out there, not looking at a place, putting on this match. This was fire, man. This main event was fire. I'm not gonna lie. Like the Rock intro was fire. That had the Brahma Bull and the fire and all of that. Another thing that stood out for me, Roman, Cody out there working like they don't have a match tomorrow. Like they just gave it their all in this. We got a lot of Roman and Cody during this match for them to have a match tomorrow, if you get what I'm saying. Like,
yeah,
I would think like they would mix it up different ways, but we got a lot of Roman and Cody during this match, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, this was good, man. This was good. The Rock pinning Cody. Like I thought Seth was gonna be there to eat the pin, but it makes sense as we see where they headed.
Yeah, look now, knowing what we know now, it makes so much sense. But what were y'all thinking like when that happened? Where Cody loses to the People's Elbow.
I loved it. I loved it because I seen the play from then. It was like, okay, I see how they're going to play it. Even though, like, you have Cody lose and now two straight WrestleMania main events, but it's all building towards tomorrow. Like, that's when I first seen that, I was like, okay, I see what they're doing. Because now if Cody went out there night two and lost that, it's like, fam, you might as well.
It's over.
You might as well go to AEW, go back there. I don't know, because it would have been over. Exactly.
Sell cars, my nigga.
So I'm not going to hold you. Like, this whole time I wanted Roman to win. After Cody lost like that on night one, I'm sitting there and I'm like, he has to win now. Like I thought that this feud could go on one more year if done correctly. And at that moment, I was like, yeah. Everything that I wanted is not gonna happen, because it would be absolute the worst case scenario.
It'll be OD. It's crazy.
Yeah, so once that happened, I thought it was very interesting. And I wondered if it was going to play a part in night two. And evidently it didn't, but it was a very, like, one day we're going to hear about how all of this happened and why it happened the way it did, and it's going to be amazing.
You're actually going to hear about it. We're recording this on Tuesday. You're going to hear about it tomorrow, Bell, because the WrestleMania doc is dropping literally tomorrow.
Which blew my mind. When they played the trailer in the arena, I'm like, that was yesterday.
12 hours ago.
I was sitting there, and The Rock is like, yeah. So when I saw Roman lose to him and Cody was holding the title, I'm like, well, he didn't say that. I just made that up. But it's like the fact that they had a doc ready to go next day.
Yeah, that was crazy. But I'll say this. Night one of WrestleMania, it didn't live up to like the other night ones, previous night ones, because we used to have like night one being that's the show that sets the tone, right? And this kind of was the show that set the tone too, but the way it ended, it was like a cliffhanger, you know what I'm saying, on some like to be continued type shit, which is, I said this in the post show, I was like, bro, this feels like right now bases is loaded. You feel me? We got another night ahead of us. I looked at what we had. You feel me? I was like, night two, honestly, is not a bad card. Like, if you look at it, I was like, we got AJ Styles, LA Knight. We got the Prophets and what's some nigga's name? God damn it. Yeah, Final Testament and the Prophets. We got Roman and Cody, fucking the triple threat for the U.S. title. So I was like, the night two card isn't bad. You feel me? So I was like, Night one basically set night two up to really knock shit out the park. And that's really what happened. You know what I'm saying? Like, night one was the perfect setup. Left everybody, you feel me? It's WrestleMania. Everybody's on a WrestleMania high. We're going to bring it down with a Cody Rhodes loss. You know what I'm saying? And then night two, bang, every match was an ill match. You know what I'm saying? There was no bad match on night two. And then you
had a card, Cody.
Yeah, let's see the night two card.
Yeah, we might as well get into it. Drew McIntyre, Seth Rollins, fire to kick things off.
My God, bro, I'm sitting there, and just like how the day before, I was like, oh yeah, this is WrestleMania. The very next 9 seconds after that match, I was like, yeah, night two is gonna be an absolute banger. There's no way that. Night one, that it's as mid as night one.
I ain't gonna hold you. So when I seen Stephanie come out before the match, I was like, night two already better. Because I already seen CM Punk there. He got there on commentary and Stephanie came out. Like, yeah, this shit already better. I ain't gonna hold you. This nigga, they went out there. This match wasn't even that long. What'd it say? 10 minutes? And they went out there and fucking, it was just getting to it off the bat, you know what I'm saying? Like, Drew kicked things off with a Claymore. I was like, yo, I thought it was over. I ain't gonna lie. How they was doing Seth? Boy, I was ready. You should have seen me in the crib. I'm hyped, foaming at the mouth, like ready to shit on Seth. But you know what I'm saying? Like, this was great. This was great between the two, man. The moment that Drew and Seth shared, like, after, you know what I'm saying, Seth, like, telling him, you fucking deserve it, all of this shit. Mm-hmm. Seth tried to win me over, man. I'm gonna talk more about Seth later, but
he won me over.
I like that, though, from Drew and Seth showing each other respect, because
sportsmanship.
Not when Drew is the ultimate, like, shit talker now, where he's like, bro, he's one day away from saying that he's going to put CM Punk in a pack. Like, once I hear that fucking Scottish man say that he's going to put somebody in a pack, I'm officially done with his character. But it was one of those things where it's like, on Monday, he kept shit-talking Seth and then kind of went, you know, that moment we had, you only know, like, when you're in there. You wouldn't understand if you never, but it was like, no, but you're still doing what you did before. So why say you respect somebody if you're going to talk shit to them afterwards?
They went in there, they battled it out. It's like, like you earn some respect for your opponent. You know what I'm saying?
You beat him fair and square.
Yeah.
But I'll say this about Drew, bro. I need Drew to crash all the way out, bro. like when I say crash all the way, like I need bro to go crazy, man. Because he's spiraling right now. But that's that. I like that though. It's character development. You know what I'm saying?
What do y'all think about Damian Priest having the title now? And I thought it would be too. So I'm like, there's so much you can do with Damian Priest and Drew. And now they immediately made Damian Priest a boring champion.
How?
His first big program is against Jey Uso.
Man, this is just the we feeding you that you remember when Drew's first I think it was one of his first opponents was Dolph Ziggler. You know what I'm saying? It's like, bro, we just gonna throw you a bone real quick to get your wins up. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yo, shout out to KP with these graphics, bro.
Facts.
This has just happened. But, yeah, nah. It's there. Everything is there for Damian Priest to be a successful champion. But it's just like, it shouldn't have been Jey Uso to be the first one. Like it felt more interesting if Ricochet would have won that match on Raw.
Hell no.
Nah, he lost me on that one.
Ricochet is an obvious, like, all right, we know what's about to happen here. And we don't even see Ricochet, like, no offense to Ricochet, love Ricochet, but him competing for the World Heavyweight Championship, come on now.
Yeah, out the blue.
You see those niggas in that Fatal 4-Way? It's like...
Word, Drew McIntyre, Bronson Reed, who, by the way, I believe he could be a World Heavyweight Champion one day. You know what I'm saying? I said this about Drew last year when they made the championship. Not Drew, Damian Priest.
Oh, yeah, you did.
I see dudes like Damian Priest holding this title. You know what I'm saying? Him, Bronson, Gable. I could see Gable holding this shit. But I like it, bro, honestly. I think... I keep calling him Drew. I'm tweaking. I think Damian's gonna be a great champion.
Yeah.
And like even his off screen character, like him, like KPQ pulled up him at the Yankees game. Like he went to the Yankees game today with the championship. He went to the club with a bottle of Ace of Spades with the championship. He looks good with this championship. That championship suits him very nicely.
I'm happy for the person Damian Priest. You know, like you say, seems like a good guy. They saying he was homeless and now he's World Heavyweight Champion and everything. Mm-hmm. I'm happy for that. The wrestler or the on screen, I gotta buy into it. I'm still not there. I'm still not all
in. Is it because his character too freaky?
That might be why. That might be why.
And but if he's successful, you know he's gonna get that eventual face turn.
Oh, it's coming. Him and Rhea, it's coming.
Him and Finn, and he's probably gonna have to face Dominic first, face Finn first, like one of those two, you know, something like that to turn into a full fledged baby face. Like him versus Dominic is the official turn.
Yeah. Damn, it was another point I was about to say, but I completely blanked. But yeah, we have to take the for me personally, I have to take the wait and see approach for Damian Priest on this one. But congratulations to him. The Pride defeated the Final Testament. How is this, man? The Philadelphia Street Fight, Snoop on commentary, Bubba Ray Dudley is the special guest ref.
This was a fun match.
Facts.
Like, maybe on TV was probably different because we got to hear Snoop on commentary, but it looked like the crowd was enjoying it from what I saw. It looked like the crowd was enjoying the match too.
I think the match is mid if Bubba Ray Dudley isn't the ref. But because he was, all they needed to do was play the hits. And that's what they did at one point. And went from being like a regular match to just once, I forgot who, was it Karrion Kross that got in Bubba's face?
Yeah.
And then once he put the glasses on, it was like, all right, let's wrap this up. And then, you know, they do all the spots and hit all the marks. I was like, you know what? I love it. I went from the match was okay to me, and then once all of that happened, I was like, yeah, this is the essence.
Shout out to B-Fab and Scarlett getting involved. Mm. I felt that was dope. That was a little added in there. I like that. But Snoop on commentary for me made this.
How was he? Like, what was he into it a lot, or?
Snoop should be on comp for every Big Four event. We need Snoop on commentary, bro. For at least one match.
Yeah.
I'm telling you. Go really? Back and watch that match with Snoop on commentary. You would cry laughing, bro. Like, the AOP went up for the double power bomb, and Snoop was like, not the double decker. I was like, what? He called it a double decker. I was like, all right, rocking with it.
All right, I'm gonna go rewatch and see if I feel different about this match.
I'm telling you, they put Eric on the table, the first table. That shit broke. They didn't even set it up right. Shit just broke.
Yo, fam, we were crying, bro. Oh my god, I totally forgot that happened. That shit was fucking hilarious.
Nigga called that shit the double decker, nigga.
Oh yeah. Said, this grandma picnic table y'all did, bro.
Word. Yo, Snoop got so many. He got so many one-liners on commentary. It's crazy. Yo,
it sounds like for whatever reason, Snoop Dogg and WrestleMania just go hand in hand. Like, yo, last year, Shane gets injured. Mm-hmm. Snoop, any other celebrity isn't doing what Snoop did, which is running in. Exactly, and hitting people's elbow to win the match that he was never in.
Legend.
Save the day, man. Honestly, bro, Snoop and WWE is a good combination.
Yeah.
Like, he's really, like, it looks like he enjoys working with them, and they love working with him. So, I don't know if y'all seen, Miz gave him a special, like, Olympic belt. Mm-hmm. So he could be, like, the ambassador for the WWE for the Olympics in France. So, yeah, it's a cool relationship they have.
Yeah, I didn't even know that. Wow. What do you so for this match, I was thinking about, like, the night before. Was it the Bianca Belair and all Bianca Belair, Naomi and Jade's match that was sponsored by Wingstop?
Yeah.
And then this match was sponsored by, you know, Gin and Juice.
100%, and they had sponsored by Agua Frescas.
Yeah, do you think that maybe they should just chill with the targeting marketing that's happening with some of these matches?
No.
Yeah, I'm with it.
Or one of the matches was sponsored by Dude Wipes. I can't remember which.
Word.
It was probably Jimmy and Jey Uso. That match was nice.
I think it was.
That match was shit.
All right. I think it was that match. But, honestly, I'm not mad at it. They getting the money. They getting to the bread. At first, I was like, yo, this is a lot of damn advertising. Like, almost too much. Like, every match was a new ad. But it is what it is. It's a prime bottle in the middle of the ring on the turnbuckles.
No, I'm not mad at the ads. I'm just, it's kind of like,
it's like a little ratio.
Yeah, just chill where you put certain ads, because it's like, bro, nobody's gonna want Gin and Juice because it happened during a Street Profits match.
Right.
Like, it would have been the same exact thing if it happened during whoever the fuck, Dominic Mysterio and all of them.
Do you think it would be better if they put Gin and Juice for the Jimmy Uso match?
I mean, is it
exactly
by a match? Is it him driving?
Jesus,
I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry. You can take that one out.
That was crazy.
I want all these plans for next Mania, and I'm over here ruining them.
Man, big shouts out to LA Knight picking up this dub over AJ Styles. Eve, how you feeling, man?
Man, LaMarcus Aldridge Knight beat my mans, bro. shit crazy. Well, I will say, my boy AJ, first off, my son AJ is yoked. Fucking jacked to the fucking brim, son. The brother has muscles on his ears. I was like, yo, why are you so jacked for fucking LA Knight? You know, it is what it is, though. I actually enjoyed the match. You feel me? I really liked this match. I thought it was good. My boy AJ held LA Knight down. You feel me? Gave him a good match. Probably his best match.
Whoa.
A win at WrestleMania.
Whoa.
You feel me? LA Knight pulled up in the damn Slim Jim mobile.
This nigga Eve said AJ Styles held down LA Knight at WrestleMania.
Word.
And then look, the I don't want this to come off as hate. The knock on AJ Styles is his WrestleMania matches. So it seemed like LA Knight held AJ Styles down.
Come on, brother. Brother, come on. Look at the greens. Okay, AJ Styles is a GOAT.
Until people look at like all of AJ's WrestleMania matches and go, wait, why was his best ones against Shane McMahon and LA Knight? But not Nakamura and Chris Jericho.
I got to run a Chris Jericho match. The Chris Jericho match. Yeah. They said, I forgot who. I think it was Shots to Gibb. I think he said the Chris Jericho match was ill. I got to run it back. I liked it. The Shane match was ill. The LA Knight match was fine. I like the LA Knight match, man.
It wasn't terrible.
Live up to standard. The Edge match was, I think the Edge match was like them niggas trying to just do too much and overthink shit. But it is what it is, man.
Which was that in the pandemic one?
Nah, that was that was 2 years ago.
AJ's trash.
38. Feel me? But yeah, man. Shouts to AJ. Shouts to LaMarcus Aldridge Knight.
This was good.
Yeah. Show was dope.
This was real good, man. So far. So right now, so far, so good. You know what I'm saying?
Look at the times of these matches too, bro. All of these matches is like
in and out.
We get into it, bro. 10 minutes, 8 minutes, 12 minutes. Like niggas is getting enough time to go out there, do what they gotta do to keep the crowd engaged. We're not going overtime to do some crazy shit, bro. It's night two, we in, we out, bro.
Uh-huh. And that leads up to the triple threat for the United States Championship. Logan Paul successfully defends his title against Kevin Owens and Randy Orton. Once again, another one.
Logan Paul, man. He's him.
I don't get it. I honestly do not understand how Logan Paul does not miss. Like somebody who's this new to wrestling, basically learning all of the psychology and everything like that as he's going. Because it's not like, we can kind of tell he wasn't a huge wrestling fan before going to the WWE. Like he was a fan, but
not a huge fan. But you know what I think it is? He may not have been like the hugest fan of the WWE beforehand, but it seems like he's a student of the game. You know what I'm saying? I may not have known everything before, but now that I'm here, it seems like he's taking the time to learn who people is. You feel me? He goes back, watches old matches, learns shit, takes shit from legends and whoever. And it's like he's, like you said, he's learning as he goes, and whatever he learns from the legends that he speaks to. I know he spoke to Randy and Edge and Ray and all these guys. Whoever he's, you know, grabbing information from, he's utilizing it. Like you could see him picking shit from this person and that person and adding game and repertoire. He's nice, bro. And he has the athleticism and size and all that.
The promo work. The promo work, I feel like, is the most important part.
Yeah.
Because once you're able to cut, like he cuts A+ promos basically every time. But then you're already like a naturally athletic person. Mm-hmm. All you got to do is learn how to do the moves, and you know, you're good to go.
He has it. He has it. Huh? He has mm-hmm. it. And to be in there with the Randy Orton, like, once again, every time I see him in there with new opponents, and he just fits right in. It doesn't seem like it's a celebrity. It's someone from out of this space joining, like, playing wrestling. You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? It doesn't feel that way at all. Another thing about this match for me is how they played the Orton and KO, like, situation. Most times with triple threat matches, you'll see, like, they go for the pin and someone, they get mad and then they start beefing and everything. It's just like, it's like they cool, but like, fam, you're not gonna go for the pin. Like, we and you hear KO, like, yo, you really want to do this right now? We could do it right now because like, yo, it's gonna, like, obviously, like, y'all cool, but it's a triple threat match. You know what I'm saying? I'm not gonna sit here and let you win. I rock with you, but fam, you know what I'm saying? Here we go. We gotta duke it out now, then so be it. You know what I'm saying? And that's something, like, once again, I feel like it's the Paul Levesque era. You know what I'm saying? It's more real shit. You know what I'm saying? Instead of this was Vince booking it, it'll be like the typical triple threat match. And they start pushing and shoving and acting mm-hmm. dumb, like after going for a pinfall. Like, no, I'm trying to win too.
You know what I like when, like, I like the fact that they both, like, they both kind of, they snakes. You know what I'm saying? It's like, Randy, you know you can't trust Randy, but at the same time, you know you can't trust KO.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we cool, but I would stab you in the back if I have to. And I like the fact that they kind of, they played into that. And I thought that was tough.
It was hanging over both of them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now, that match, even in the arena, everybody was going up for this match. That one, that, what was the match before this one?
The
LA Knight.
Yeah.
So that match, it the LA Knight and AJ Styles one, it, from what I remember, it didn't have that many, like, big pops. Like, you know, LA Knight winning, you know, is cool because LA Knight's also probably one of the most popular and over people in wrestling right now. Like, you know, walking in the arena, everybody's just fucking yelling. I never want to hear the word yeah after this weekend with how much people are yelling that shit out all day, every day. But this match, like, everybody was into it from the beginning to when people recognized that Speed was the one in the costume. So I do love that aspect that now Logan's just going to bring, like, a new person in this fucking, you know, bottle costume everywhere. And, yeah, no, everybody was definitely into this match. I love this match. Like, from the beginning to the end, I was basically standing up the entire time.
Yeah, definitely didn't tune out at all. Nice. Nothing. Like, so far throughout the whole show, like, I was tapped in mm-hmm. the whole show. Well, to be honest, Speed, how you feel about Orton kicking him right in his shit?
Bro, the bottle cap flew off on a costume.
Yo, Speed started barking at Randy Orton, boy. Randy kicked the fuck out of him, son. That was the funniest shit. When I tell you, I was crying and laughing, bro. I texted Banks. I'm like, yo, this nigga Speed is, I can't say the word. But I was like, this nigga Speed is crazy, bro. Like, I was like, yo, Randy probably broke one of his ribs for real, kicking him now.
Facts.
You feel me? And then he RKO'd him. He took the RKO cool, too. I was like, all right, good for you, Speed.
I love the fact they mixing it up with the streamers and the outside. I love it, man.
I got to pop out next year.
Facts.
I wouldn't be shocked. I would not be shocked if that that happens in one of those, if he's like the next person in the costume.
That'd be fire.
Yeah, mm-hmm. that would be very dope. Speed getting the reaction he did though, because like. Not that many, like, a lot of people knew who he was, but when he, like, they showed his face and everything like that, and then me and all my boys are laughing, and we're like, what, like, the fact that he's even there, and then the like, people trying to figure out who Speed is in real time, and it's like a bunch of, like, kids telling their parents who, like, oh, he's a streamer, all these things, blah, blah, blah. It was pretty interesting to watch it all play down, but I loved it.
If you're not on the internet, you wouldn't have known. Cody, exactly. You know who Speed was?
Yeah, I know who Speed was. Damn, this nigga think I'm ancient. Y'all niggas think I'm.
You didn't know Keith Lee.
That's TikTok world. That's a TikTok world's a whole. That's I didn't even have TikTok at the time. I didn't have the app on my phone.
That's fair.
Yeah, that was different. But another thing, like I like the pop up power bomb into the RKO. I like that. That was dope. That was fire.
Absolutely insane. I did not see that shit coming at all. Yo, Randy Orton. Goat. What a run. What a run. He's a goat.
Yeah.
He seems like such a cool dude now, bro. Like I was like you mentioned the sit down with him and Punk when they watched their WrestleMania match.
Mm-hmm.
I watched it last week. I watched it on Sunday actually. And I'm watching, I'm like, bro, like this is a completely different Randy Orton from what like we grew up with. You know what I'm saying? Like you could tell like now he's just like a much like cool, just chill dude. You feel me? He's chilling now. Like he's just a veteran. He's here to do his thing, you feel me, entertain and have fun. Cause like he said, he don't know how much time he got left doing this. So hey, I love new Randy. You feel me?
Did you find it funny about that that thing with CM Punk and Randy, where they were basically saying that they kind of didn't fuck with each other and they actually hated each other during that whole program that they were having with each other, but they still managed to make it work and make money from it?
Right. Now they're best buds.
And meanwhile, in AEW, bro, if you're beefing, you got to create a whole new TV show.
Right.
Punk, I mean, I'm sure we're going to get to it, but Punk seems so damn happy now. Like, even when he came out at the end of the show, we're going to get to it.
Yeah. Another thing about Randy is, like, him, like, in this new age of, like, wrestling and everything, he's still going out there. Like, it's more high-flying. It's more of these moves where you go out there and put yourself on the line. Randy is still doing Randy, and he's still putting on fire, just being him. Mm-hmm. He ain't got to do too much, you know what I'm saying? And it's still working. It's still great quality. Like, he's a goat, man, for real. Bro,
with this match, he probably did maybe like 15 different moves total. Like, most of the time, some of the moves were probably all the same. But he just hit all the marks because he knows, like, what is going to make the most sense. What, like, not doing too much. Figuring out, like, he has all the psychology figured out in wrestling.
Yeah.
So he don't need 150 flips just to fucking get a pop out of somebody. All he has to do is kick speed in the chest. He gets the same reaction.
You see? Yep. That's exactly, man. That's why he's so respected by, like, his peers and everything like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yo, another thing, too, because I know I'm probably going to forget. Y'all seen, heard Pat McAfee on commentary cursing. He said, like, he cursed, like, at least four times.
He said shit a couple times.
Yeah. He was letting it fly. I'm like, yo, wrestling lit. We here, son.
There's a lot of cursing going on lately.
Thanks to The Rock.
Yeah, The Rock on Raw yesterday, he said, fuck. He was like, I don't know if they bleeped it or not. Well, I'm assuming they did on...
He bleeped it.
Yeah, but... Yeah... I think Triple H is telling people to do that. Even Speed was cursing. And I guess, you know, he doesn't know any better, but...
Yeah, I think it's because he's on the spectrum.
Nigga named Speed.
He's slow in real life.
You know what I'm saying? Somehow it makes sense. Oh man, we're gonna get into this Bayley getting her moment at WrestleMania, defeating Io Sky, new women's champion. Oh man, another one.
Heat.
Another banger, man. They brung it. Io Sky. Yo, she was off of beans, huh?
She was too.
She was wild.
When she reversed the rose plant to whatever Bayley calls it. When she popped up out of that, I was like,
that shit was crazy.
Okay.
Like, yo, she hit a moonsault, went for the pin, didn't get it, went up, hit a moonsault,
off the first rope, went to the second rope, did another moonsault.
And I'm like, yo, all right, you like, you off some shit right now.
She was trying to figure out what's all right, how high do I need to go? I'm gonna keep doing these damn ropes until I figure it out.
Word, until I win.
Yo, she went crazy. They went insane, son. They really went crazy.
Hell yeah. Now Bailey, yeah. Bailey showed up. I'm not
saying.
Nah, it's nothing bad. I was just gonna say I'm just happy for Bailey because she finally she got her moment, and she is slept on, like, as far as like, and it's crazy to even say that because we know how nice Bailey is, but niggas just keep, I don't know. I feel like she don't get the adoration like the Charlottes and the Beckys and even the damn Sashas. You know what I'm saying? Like, she's looked at as last in the group, but she's nice. You know what I'm saying? Like,
well, maybe it's because like she was probably the biggest in NXT. So, you know, Sasha, Charlotte, and especially Becky had the most time to grow with fans and stuff like that. Versus, you know, Bailey was she had the wavy arm inflatable shits and things like that. And, you know, she was definitely one of the most over people in NXT period, like men and women. So, yeah. You know, it's tougher once you're that top person to stay at the top of somebody's list when you have somebody like a Becky, you know, having all these matches and all these moments and becoming a bigger star versus Bailey when you're already like, all right, well, she was the best at one point. I'm not going to keep saying she's the best when other people are putting in different types of work all at the same time.
Yeah, I think Vince not taking a liking to her as much as the other three, and your way of like being presented on television for so long. Like, you know what I'm saying? She was always in the shadows. It's just like now you like that's what the consumer is used to, I guess. You know what I'm saying? It's kind of hard to figure out because like skill wise, she's right there with him, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So the one thing though, I do have to say this, she needs a new finish.
Yeah. I'm not feeling the I think it's called the rose plant, something like that, but
yeah,
whatever that is, I'm not feeling it either.
Yeah, that's the one thing about it for me is like she needs a new finish. But congrats to Bailey, man. It's much deserved, well deserved.
Mm-hmm.
Facts.
The fact that it took this long too, it's like, jeez.
Yeah, like I was saying, it's just like they got this motivation to go out there and put on a banger, and they did not disappoint. Jey Uso, Jimmy Uso, we talking to you. man, and then we get to the main event, Cody Rhodes, the new undisputed WWE champion.
Man, when we say cinema, man. So, all right, so I'll start, bro, and I'll say this. The whole time, like, leading back to, like, the Rumble and everything and The Rock interjecting himself into this whole shit and me saying it don't make sense, they found a way to make it, like, even in that, like, confusion and all that, I was like, bro, they found a way to, like, somewhat just make it work. Because it was like, the whole time I'm like, yo, why is this so chaotic? Like, I'm questioning the whole time. Like, and when I say the whole time, I mean, in back when he won the Rumble to The Rock, the weeks leading up to Mania, I'm like, yo, why is this so chaotic? I was like, it really could just be this simple. It could just be boom, 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 A, B, C. But this match, it needed all of that chaos. Honestly, like, I don't want to say it needed it, but it just, the chaos elevated this match and the story, honestly, to the point where it's like, yo, like when Cody won that blow off, it was like the fucking place erupted, bro. You feel me? The whole crowd went up.
Yeah.
People online crying, everybody crying, happy, overwhelmed with emotion and everything. It needed all of that chaos. It needed all of that confusion. It needed all the swerves it needed all of that, honestly. So looking back, I'm like, all right, like they messed up trying to intervene and interject the Rock in it, but they fixed it somehow with all this chaotic shit that they did. Like they just kept they literally kept everybody on their toes until Mania, and then we got what we got, which is fire.
This is exactly it. Lived up to the hype. It lived up to everything I wanted it to be. The appearances from the Usos, Solo, John Cena, The Rock, Undertaker, fam. That was the Seth. And it's kind of Seth too. You're right, Seth. Mm-hmm. And it was obviously it was supposed to be Stone Cold. You know what I'm saying? I think that would have been the icing on the cake right there.
So I think I figured out why it wasn't Stone Cold. Like I don't the Stone Cold and Roman, have they ever had anything?
Nah.
Yeah, so I think everybody that was there were only like you're part of the story in some way. Undertaker and Roman at WrestleMania becoming it's his yard now. I don't know why The Rock got chokeslammed by The Undertaker. I was still trying to figure that part out.
That's the only thing. It's just like, yeah, he has something with Roman, but he didn't touch Roman. He didn't do nothing to Roman. It was more so The Rock.
Mm-hmm. And then John Cena and The Rock, that you know, obviously.
Yeah. John Cena and Solo, the last time we seen Cena,
mm-hmm.
Solo won the match and sadly he spiked him to death and shit like that. So I like the way that they tied everything and incorporated everything.
We're one Twitter account away, like one Twitter user is going to tweet out, oh yeah, this is what happened when The Undertaker last saw The Rock. And it's going to make sense why, you know, The Undertaker popped in and chokeslammed him.
Right.
So.
Fam, like, even if you want to, Stone Cold don't even make that much sense. You know what I'm saying? And that's what people expected, to be honest. But it's like, either way, son.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the wow factor. It's the chaos of it all. Like that for me, it was just like, fam, I'm like, yo, what's going on, son?
Rock white bell bottoms.
Fam, I love that shit, son.
I wonder if The Rock knows that what he's doing now, to me, feels like some of the best things that he's like in the last month, I want to give it. Whenever he started posting those promos on Twitter and shit like that,
mm-hmm.
he's hit a groove right now where it's like, bro, he's the perfect bad guy.
Yeah.
Like, this is my favorite bad guy Rock.
I'm happy he took that route, because we was getting to the point to where with The Rock, it's the same old shit.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And for him to switch it up and just like become the most entertaining thing by far, leading up to WrestleMania, man, it goes to show, like, fam, he's really one of the greatest ever.
Yeah, undeniable. This moment right here.
Fam, and this is another thing, man. Like the story within that, you know what I'm saying? I know y'all seen what was going on, like Roman taking the time. He could have hit Cody and he ended up hitting Seth with the chair. And it's just, once again, the Triple H era, we don't get that layer of the story without that. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? We don't get that if Vince was in charge.
If Vince was in charge, it's still Roman Rock.
Word. Niggas gonna like this shit. That's it.
One way or another. Yo. Also, yeah, I want to say, yo, Seth is probably my MVP of the weekend, bro. I'm not.
Oh my god!
Like I said before, Seth, you won me over, pal.
Bro, he couldn't even walk to get in the ring. at the end of this.
The fucking company guy, Seth, is, man. When niggas say, and I die for this shit, that's Seth, bro.
Well, he was a part of three different matches in major ways in one WrestleMania.
Bro, he gave up he was going to give the shit up anyways, but World Heavyweight Championship, held it for a year, got it to a point, elevated, made it relevant, you know what I'm saying? Cool. Drew McIntyre beats him, gives up his championship, helps Cody Rhodes, you feel me, in the tag team match. Nigga, my leg gone, bro. I can't walk. You see me out here, bro. I'm on the ground.
Get up!
You feel me? On the floor. Can't walk, can't move. You feel me? But I'm still out here. Still, I show up the next night to help you defeat this nigga. Sacrificial lamb. You feel me? Nigga hit me in the back with the chair. Come on, bro.
And it plays the story. He said he's gonna be his shield. And
oh, man.
The triple entendre. Yeah. So even ask me how.
Seth is the ultimate company dude, bro. To help a nigga that beat you three times in a row, you feel me, become champ? Come on, bro.
Look, and obviously
the greater good, man. Seth is the goat, bro.
Seth definitely did suffer the most out of he suffered the most out of this whole buildup, like by far. It's not close. And even to the point to where I'm watching the match, this nigga didn't even get a chance to do nothing with the chair and got knocked smooth the fuck out. I was like, fam, I was ready to, boy, I was ready. Once again, I'm ready to shit on Seth, man.
They but like on Seth for the past 4 months, bro.
This shit is fun.
Been calling him retarded, all types of shit.
I ain't gonna lie. This is the most fun I had shitting on the nigga, son. I ain't gonna lie, son. It's just fun because I love Seth. I really do. Right. And like, it's just what he sacrificed to give us this moment. And the fact, before all of this nigga was coming off a torn MCL. He was rushing back for this shit.
Word.
It's like, fam, like, nah, like Seth, man, like, as much as I want to keep it funny and keep it jokes, man, but thank you, you know what I'm saying? It's because somebody had to take the, you know what I'm saying? You can't make Cody look so bad because we about to crown him champ on Sunday. It's like, the Rock is the Rock, and Roman got the longest. Somebody got to eat these L's, you know what I'm saying? Somebody got to look like a dweeb, and Seth, you did for us.
Did you guys know that this was technically two title wins for Cody?
Technically, yeah, it is.
Yeah, I saw like a screenshot on Twitter that said like Cody, like it showed his bio that says Cody won the Universal title once and the WWE title once. I'm sitting there and I'm like, And then the Pat McAfee clip comes out of Cody mentioning that he wants to change the title.
Yeah, to the Wendy.
Mm-hmm. Even though I'm kind of over it, I think I like this design more than the Winged Eagle because it makes more sense, like as a brand.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, he's your main champion. But I don't know. I feel like this Mania, this ending. Is there even a better Mania ending to anything?
Yeah, we got to talk about that ending, man. That ending was beautiful.
Hell yeah.
My God.
Everybody running out to the ring to hold him up. Feel me?
Man. Nick Khan, the CEO, hugging him. Bruce Pritchard, Triple H coming out. They were instrumental in bringing him back.
They gave him a Rolex.
Yeah, that was fire, too. And
no, not just a Rolex.
Shit was bust down.
It was.
Nah, I would have did this shit. I was like, man, fuck this title, nigga. I'm the real one.
It was the same exact Rolex that Dusty pawned to get money to put Cody into like acting classes or wrestling school or some shit like that.
Yeah, acting classes when, yeah.
Yeah, so that was the significance behind it.
And Cody, he gave Seth, Rock, and Roman Rolexes as well.
He did?
Yeah.
That's funny. I know all that.
They all got the like it's engraved for like some shit for main event in night one.
I think it said like 40 or something like that.
Yeah.
So like everybody involved got it, bro. They were handing out Rolexes like nothing, bro. Everybody was getting Rolexes this weekend.
My nigga Cody out here watched up, nigga.
Man, wait, what do you think they give out in AEW? They're selling out like.
Take out his Casio. Man, you get a Movado watch.
Kenny Omega goes, all right, here you go, take a shit. Here's his watch. Here's his watch for helping me sell out 2,000 tickets for our biggest show of the year.
Here goes this Movado watch.
Yo.
If you press the center, it goes, anyway. Yo,
I'm laughing because Eve said it before. Nigga just said it again. Like, nigga, the hero. That's what made it bad funnier.
Something about the Movado, man.
You've been in one too many Macy's.
Word. I wore my pops Movado watch to prom. That shit was mad big, falling off my wrist and shit. Like, I'm at prom doing this shit all night. He's like, where you got the wrist piece? I'm like, do I?
You take that bullshit off. Shit sagging like jeans.
Shit like, fell off my wrist. I look down.
Yo, MJF is probably sitting there like, do I want Michael Kors watch? Or I might be able to get a couple Rolexes out of this one.
Yo.
You sacking Michael Kors watches on top of each other like silly bands.
Yeah.
Hey, yo, you got to take that drop from Eve.
Another Michael Kors watch from Chris Jericho. Gee, thanks, man.
Nigga throw it
off the cruise.
Nigga shoot a skyhook with that shit. Like, whatever. Man. Shouts to Cody Rhodes, man. This shit was awesome, bro. I ain't gonna lie.
Kind of made me want season finales in wrestling.
I mean, technically.
That's what exactly what it felt like.
Like, yo, if we had like a little month break.
Oh, off season?
Yeah, give us 1 month off.
Nah, we can't do that.
Mm-mm.
The money I'm moving.
Yeah, wow. They just announced like 17 different countries for the rest of the year.
Yeah, they're gonna be in Eastern Europe for the next 6 months.
Yeah,
yo,
they do an elimination chamber in Turks and Caicos.
Yo, them Mania checks, man. I know they what niggas is eating right now.
My God, Cody's about to buy another Rolex.
Word, he about to give one to everybody on the roster, nigga.
Yeah.
Yes.
Bro, he made $1 million off of merch alone. Well, the WWE did. But also, those reports, they were coming out. But I just want the people to know there was only Cody Rhodes merch everywhere. There was nobody else's merch. There was six Cody Rhodes shirts at every single merch stand. No, zero Roman Reigns shirts, John Cena baby blue shirt, and Rhea Ripley mommy shirt, and a couple yeah shirts from LA Knight.
Right.
Roman got no merch whatsoever. Like, most people didn't have merch at the stands. It was all Cody. So it was a concentrated effort to get him to that number.
As he should. They're smart.
Hey, man.
That's smart.
Yes. Roman been doing that shit for 4 years, man. Let Cody have his one weekend, bro. Let Cody have his one weekend, man.
Just one.
Yo, for a decade, I try to convince him I could be their star player, but it seems we have reached a point where neither saw that in me. Damn.
Yeah, nigga, it wasn't it then. You gotta leave and rebuild, come back, man.
If he thought that he could have been this without all of that happening, like, come on. Well, he wouldn't have known that. That, you know, if he thought that he was somebody then, he was smoking crack.
He had it. Probably not to this magnitude. I feel like that, you know, he had some gimmicks to where he turned them shits into shit. Like, mm-hmm. It's just like niggas ain't see him as that guy.
Yeah, I didn't before, especially once he turned into Stardust. I was over the Stardust thing.
That was it. That was the barrier right there.
Oh yeah.
Even though he put on a banger with John Cena for the U.S. title, one random Raw for no reason, or SmackDown or whatever the fuck it was, but. Yeah, I mean, him going to the indies and doing everything with the Young Bucks, he needed that in life. Like, to learn how to be a top guy, pause. So,
it's all a part of growth, brother, man. You gotta, every man reaches a point where you gotta leave the crib and get your bumps and bruises, you feel me, and come back a better man. That's what he did, bro.
Hey, reminds me of Drew McIntyre.
Yeah,
exactly.
Drew did the same thing. I'm saying LeBron James. You know what I'm saying? They got to leave. I can't win in the Klee in the land. I gotta leave, bro. I gotta leave. You feel me? I gotta go to the Yams where it's lit at. Come back. And now I can win the championship.
You feel me? So Cody's leaving WWE to go back to AEW at some point.
Damn. No.
Oh.
Almost died, man. But no.
I got too radical.
Yeah.
But yeah, man. Overall, this shit was a fantastic WrestleMania, bro. Honestly. Like, they, nigga, aside from the records and all that, bro, just great execution. Like, I saw somebody on TikTok that was like, yo, do you know how on point you have to be for, he was like, lighting, music, cues, like all that, for everybody to come out, hit, they do what they have to do with this, the perfect time. Like, he was like, the shit was so perfect that they did on Sunday night, that he was like, it's damn near impossible to like do that live somewhere else. Like, he was like, that shit was so fucking perfect, bro. Like, and when you look back at it, Shit really was perfect, bro. Everything from Cena coming out to Rock coming out to Rome, just everything about the shit was perfect, bro. Now that right there is some real music, man. Oh, also, they did an entire weekend. Niggas buried Vince McMahon, bro. They made sure a concentrated effort to spit on Vince McMahon however they could. Paul Heyman in his speech. Yeah, he was like, man, this is the Paul Levesque era. Everybody giving Triple H his flowers this weekend, saying it's the Paul Levesque era. It's great to work under Triple H. You feel me? It's all peaches and cream.
Why do you think that is, though? Obviously, there's something behind all of this. Pat McAfee called it the Paul Levesque era on Friday when he was interviewing Triple H. Then later that night, that same night, Paul Heyman says it. Stephanie McMahon says it at Mania. Why name the era after Triple H? While we're in the era, and it's just beginning, by the way.
Who else do we name it after?
I don't. Even Triple H said it on Pat McAfee on Friday. He was like, "We didn't call it the Attitude Era in the Attitude Era." We didn't call it ruthless aggression in the ruthless aggression era.
Well, so it's like, why? So you think it's too early to be naming it?
They're trying to make it a thing, and I'm trying to figure out why.
Because he's in charge. It's the new regime, and he's he's spearheading it. That's why.
But Vince was in charge the entire time for like 40 years, 50 years.
This shit ain't the Vince era.
Exactly.
It's a new it's day. It's
named after something else.
I think of Manny thinking way too deep.
No, but because it's like, but why do they keep doing it? There's a reason behind it. I'm telling you.
You want me to tell you, Manny? They're having fun, Manny. It's a new day. It's different back there, man. You hear it on commentary. You see what's going on with the product, man. It's just new, man.
Manny might be onto something.
Here we go.
No. Disney's wise.
This nigga on his knees, man. Yeah.
No, y'all. So a lot has happened over this past week. Mm-hmm. Like before we recorded last week, Vince made a statement about something.
He did?
Yeah, like he's commented, like apparently in too much detail about this situation. I just found that out today.
Nigga, who did he talk to? Nigga, Al Qaeda. I hear this.
Kasanat. I don't know. Also, Endeavor, TKO's owner or whatever, was sold, or part of it was sold.
Yep.
So it's a concentrated and TKO bought some of Vince's shares back on Monday.
$300 and something mil.
Yeah. Like, so they are getting this nigga out of here completely. Yeah. Like, he still owns a ridiculous amount, but they're trying to buy his stuff back. Mm. So it is a concentrated effort, branding-wise, to just clean this shit up, literally. So, there you go. Manny was on to something.
Well, I mean, I also have to clean it up after this nigga Vince.
Yeah, that's obvious.
Shit it on its back.
Yeah.
We're not going to call it a new era after this nigga was shitting on
people. No, no, you can call it a new era. It was just weird to me that they were calling it the Paul Levesque era.
Well, it's the Paul Levesque era because he's, like I said, he's the guy spearheading all this shit. He's the chief content or creative officer, whatever you call it. He's the guy behind the pen. You feel me? With the book. He's the guy with the pen. So that's why they call him the Paul Levesque era. What we've seen is because of him. All this creative shit and all this new shit is because of him. That's why. I don't think it's that deep to be calling it. I mean, what else are we going to call it?
I think, but here's why. Like, things where people try to insinuate, like, even Ronda Rousey, even though, like, nobody was really giving a fuck about what she was saying, they just ran with it because it was a good headline. Where they were like, she's running it behind the scenes, and like Bruce Pritchard is a puppet and shit like that. Mm-hmm. I feel like that's, you know, a reason why, like, to call it the Paul Levesque era, so that there's no confusion as to who's doing what and why. So, I don't know.
You think Triple H? I get you. I just don't want to go too deep into that.
I'm gonna take my tinfoil hat off for this one moment, but in a couple months, if it gets weird again, we're gonna revisit.
We gotta read Rhonda's book and see what she says.
All right, maybe we'll never know.
Man, yo, what's final thoughts on WrestleMania, man?
I mean, for me, 10 out of 10. Even with the okay night one, night two was that amazing.
Yeah, same for me, bro. I said on the pre-show, not the pre-show, the post-show, night one was just we setting everything up. You feel me? Bases loaded. Night two, we come through, hit the grand slam, knock everything out the park, and that's exactly what they did. And I love it, bro. Love the new era. Love the new champion. Love the show, WrestleMania. You know what I'm saying? Like, I love everything about this weekend, man. Like, this weekend is what, and I know we say this a lot, saying this is what it's all about, but this really is what it's all about. You know what I'm saying? Seeing everybody go home happy, seeing the emotion, seeing the pageantry, seeing the great matches. Like, everything about it was 10 out of 10, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would have to agree. Night one, I got me an all-time main event, fire main event. I got to see The Rock, yep. One mixing it up. with the two new stars in it, and today with Roman as his partner, and I got a night too full of straight heat with an all-timer main event, probably one of the best matches I've seen, with the most excitement that had me jumping out of my chair, excited, feeling all the feels, man, from every emotion, man. I cannot complain about WrestleMania at all, man.
Facts.
This aren't you glad it's not a one night anymore?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. One night, yeah. Would there, bro. They would have had to start the show like 5 o'clock.
Bro.
And it still would have went till past midnight.
My God. I was thinking about that the other day. I'm like, yo, if all this shit was in one night, I would have hated this fucking Mania because I would have been that exhausted.
Hell yeah. Man, what a time.
I could play a little round of applause, man.
There it is. WrestleMania 40.
In its entirety, bro. Shit crazy.
We don't get paid enough.
That's a story for a different day. We got it's some TTMNs, but we honestly, we've been running for 3 hours, so we gonna move next week. Yeah, but for the meantime, Cody, take us out of here, man.
I give my all. I give my all.
I have nothing else to say. God bless you all.
Man. That's even work for me, too.
I know, let's see. I don't know how to do it.
Nigga get dead.
Hold on, move to the left a little bit.
Nah,
like listen, maybe centered.
Just know, I bought all of my podcast shit to Mania. And got too drunk to use my podcast shit. So last time coming soon.
Yo, shouts to everybody that went to WrestleMania, had a good time, made it out safe. If I saw you out in Philly, I love you. You know what I'm saying? If I didn't get to see you, there's a lot of people I did not get to see. I still love you. You feel me? We're going to link up soon. YouTube.com/BlackAndOutsTable. Tap in. Check out the post show. Check out the Becky Lynch interview. Check out the reels and everything that we got up. You feel me? Go thumbs up everything also. Patreon.com/BlackAndOutsTable. Lots of content up there as well. You know who I am. You know who I be. We're up out of here, man.
Get up!